This one goes forward.
Hello, everyone. My name is Benjamin Goffin. I'm a PhD student at the University of Virginia. Today, I'd like to talk to you about a mega drought that has impacted the Maipo Basin in central Chile. In the next 10 minutes, I make you this promise that you will learn a little more about how we can use Earth observations from space to learn more about the conditions on the ground as they are being impacted by a mega drought. As far as the outline for my talk, I'd like to break it into two sections, and they have to do with the time I've spent in my PhD. I've been working on my PhD for about 2.5 years, and in the earlier stages, I worked with people through a program at NASA, and so I'd like to talk about that collaboration and what I've learned from these people, and then I'd like to talk about some of my more recent research and some takeaways from that. So in the summer of 2022, I was part of the NASA Developed National Program. For 10 weeks, I led a team of 4 scholars within NASA Developed, and we worked very closely with the Embassy of Chile and stakeholders in Chile. And so this has been a very formative experience for me. One of the fundamental part of NASA Developed is to work hand in hand with partners. So in this case, partners in Chile. During those 10 weeks and in the collaboration that followed, I'd like to share some of the things that I've learned from the partners over there. So the Maipo Basin has been impacted by a mega drought. This term of mega drought was first described by Dr. René Garraud, who is standing right over there. I don't claim to know as much as him on the matter, but I have used this satellite, GPM, which looks at precipitation from day to day globally. And so in doing that, we can look at the Maipo Basin and we can pick different cities in the Maipo Basin, whether they are close to the Andes, like San Jose, or on the coast, like San Antonio. And so we can monitor how much precipitation there is every year. What we see is that typically this region is pretty dry. It gets about 500 millimeters of precipitation. In 2010, there is a mega drought that begins there. Precipitation goes down and temperature goes up. One thing that I found when looking at this data is that mostly there is a sharp deficit in precipitation starting in 2018. And so when I worked at NASA Developed, one of the things we were tasked to do was to implement Earth observations to try to assess the crop water use. And so we got data from Chile. We used Earth observations from NASA, in this case, Landsat 8. And so the particular data set we are using is called NDVI. It is an indicator of the crop greenness. So we can look at different corn parcels in the Maipo Basin, like the three I'm showing here. We can look at them in different years, and we can see how they behave through time. So one thing that we see is that when it begins in October at the growing season, the colors are pretty dark, and then as we get closer to January, we have greener conditions as the crops are growing, and then it goes down. One way to summarize this is to create a plot such as this one. And so again, we are looking at NDVI on the left axis in red, and we look at NDVI in these different parcels. One thing that's very important here is that we are comparing it with KC. KC is the crop coefficient. It's a very important measure when trying to predict the crop water use. And so what we've done here is that we were able to relate Landsat 8 NDVI with crop coefficient KC, and we built this relationship specifically for the Maipo Basin. So this is one thing I took away from NASA Develop. We wrote a paper, we have many co-authors there, many people around the table who work together to come up with this publication. And the case that we make is that using Landsat 8, using NDVI, we can gain information for crop irrigation. This is a photo I took. I'd like to take a moment. I'd like you to look at this image, and I'd like to ask you this question. What might be the limitation of using one NDVI model to capture the conditions on the ground? the image shows that there is a lot of variation in agricultural practices there on the ground in Chile. In this case, you are looking at avocado plantations. You see that they are planted in the valley, they are planted on the hillsides, they are planted differently, managed differently, irrigated differently. Therefore, they perform and they react differently, and it's really hard to capture that from space, especially looking at a variable such as NDVI. Perhaps one way to capture that also comes from space, but it's a different sensor. This one is 400 kilometers above our head. It is hosted on the International Space Station, and it is called the Ecosystem Spaceborne Thermal Radiometer Experiment aboard the International Space Station, or ECOSTRES. What ECOSTRES does is that it measures the radiations from the Earth's surface, and it calculates the crop water use and crop water need. This is something I'm very interested in. This is also something that partners in Chile were interested to look into. So over the last few months, I was fortunate to be traveling to Chile, and I was hosted by CIREN. CIREN is the Centro de Información de Recursos Naturales. CIREN works to advance land use planning. And so just like me, they are very interested in looking at crop water dynamics and seeing what might be some of the applications of ecostress. I'd like to share with you three capabilities that I believe come with the ecostress product. This one is a map of the Maipo Basin in Chile. What it shows you is how many observations you have over a three-month period. So as the International Space Station returns over the site, what you see is that we gain new measurements from ecostress. The first takeaway is that on average, we have measurements from ecostress, valid measurements of ecostress, over this region every few days. So that's the first takeaway. Another thing we can do is look at the measurements from ecostress in contrast to measurements from other satellites. In this case, I'm looking at Terra Modis, and so we can compare ET measurements from the two. ET stands for evapotranspiration. It is the amount of water that the crop uses. When we look at MODIS ET, we see that it is a value, a composite value, every 8 days. And so it gives us a snapshot of what ET looks like at an 8-day interval. What we see from ecostress is that it's a very different pattern, because ecostress captures ET at different times of day and on different days. And so what you get from these two products is drastically different. So this is my second takeaway from ecostress. One of the big capabilities is that it gives us information that did not exist previously looking at satellites such as Terra Modis. Now I'd like to use a concrete example and zoom in on a particular town in the Maipo Basin. This town is Melipilla. It is located 1 hour southwest of Santiago. Melipilla has a population of about 120,000 people, and as you can see here, it also has a lot of agricultural parcels. Some of them, like these right here, have irrigation pivots as long as 500 meters. So these parcels are very big. When we look at them with information from satellites, we see that they are big, but the information from satellite can also be very coarse. So here I am showing you information from Terra Modis. Again, still evapotranspiration information from Terra Modis at the end of 2020. I converted Modis ET into a daily measure. What we see is that most of the area is in the red. The ET measures are pretty low. Also, the fields that previously looked really big are now pretty small when compared to the pixel size of MODIS ET. This is a 500 meter resolution. The next thing I want to do is swap this data set for the one from ecostress. We are going to look at estimates at about the same time of the year as well, but with a different data set. This is what things look like using ecostress. Previously, We had very coarse pixels. We didn't have much variation spatially. Now we see that with eco-stress data at a resolution of 70 meters, not only do we gain insight into what is happening between parcels, but also within those particular parcels. Before I conclude, I'd like to think about what this means for water resource management. And so having this sort of information at a very fine resolution, or information from Landsat 8, I think it can help us, and it can help us gain insight into agricultural practices, but not only that. I think it can help us also better understand what water rights allocations, what they mean on the ground, and then they can also help us think about climate change and adaptation to climate change. This research, it was funded by the University of Virginia, and what my sponsors were most excited about is what this work means in terms of community livelihood and community health. And so with that, I'd like to acknowledge my collaborators, my research advisor at the University of Virginia, Dr. Venkat Lakshmi, undergraduate student, Dia Gupta, and then my partners at CIRA and Fernando Nera and Carlos Calvo. There are so many other co-authors within NASA Develop and NASA Langley, right there. And so I'd like to also say thank you to AGU for this opportunity and the work done by the staff and the funding that they provided for me to come here.